I would like, first of all, thanks organizers of this wonderful meeting, and so many diverse, interesting topics were discussed. And basically, I'm very happy to hear that there is discussion about everything, time and so on, so people really take attention. And thanks for letting me talk about the Kitaev interaction here. So, dear Boris, first of all, congratulations, happy birthday, and tanti auguri, how they say in this part of the world, which I know you like a lot. And I was really wondering why you like it so much, and now I understood. So, basically, 60 on that part of the world where you spent winter is actually 16 in Celsius in this part of the world, so happy, happy sweet 16. Okay. And I'll go to the topic of my talk. So let me start with acknowledging my collaborators. The, most of the work which I'm going to present today is done with my postdoc, Ioannis Roussos-Hatzakis, and with Craig Price, who is now in Penn State. And some earlier work, which motivated actually this recent study, was done with Yuri Suzuk, who is also in University of Minnesota, and with Peter Wolfe. And I will also acknowledge Stefan Rachel, Johannes Reuter, and Ronnie Tamali because they were interested in this model and they did FRG study of this model. Okay, so here's the outline of my talk. As you can see, I'm talking about something quite different from the rest of the conference. So I will start with introduction and I will try to explain why anisotropic Kitaev interaction are in principle possible in system with a strong spin orbit coupling and a certain type of geometry. For example, you need a honeycomb lattice or hexagonal geometry. And I would also argue that in some particular system, not only nearest neighbor Kitaev interactions are possible, but also second neighbor interactions are possible and actually are very important, and at least they help to resolve several puzzles related to one of the most studied iridate, which is sodium iridate. And basically, the main topic of my talk is I want to present a new frustrated model, which we call K1, K2. K stay for Kitaev interaction on nearest neighbor, and K2 for Kitaev interaction on the second neighbor, on the honeycomb lattice. And I just want to show you that this model is very interesting, non-trivial, and you will see that this non-triviality is actually reflected in a very different classical and quantum phase diagram for this model. And basically, I will conclude at the end. Okay, so I will start from the beginning. I will start from why we are interested and worried about these materials. And basically, in the strongly correlated electron community, people were working a lot for 3D system, where the main interactions are Coulomb interaction, and basically something else like spin orbit coupling, relativistic interactions are sometimes rarely important, but in any case, they're significantly smaller. If we are going down in the periodic table, so correlations decreases, they become weaker and weaker, while the atoms become heavier and heavier, and basically when they reach age of 77, this is another happy age for elements, then the spin orbit coupling constant can be more or less of the same order of magnitude as Coulomb interaction. And basically, iridates, and I will show in a moment why iridates who are attracting a lot of attention in the community, they basically, it can be explained using the phase diagram, which was suggested by Leon Balitz and Mitropesin. These iridates, they sit in between. So basically, they have significant role of correlation. U is not small, but spin orbit coupling is already large. And therefore, in this phase diagram where they plot, so here is the ratio of Coulomb repulsion with respect to the bandwidth. And you know that if you go to 5D elements, they become bigger and bigger. So, and then here is the spin orbit coupling also normalized by bandwidth. So they sit in the middle, and somehow in different iridates, you can see the physics which is belonging anywhere around them. So basically, some of iridates was suggested to be showing like topological insulator properties, or it's also it's mode insulator, and it's actually spin orbit coupling assistant mode insulator, where some of the traditional mode physics can be studied in the presence of strong spin orbit coupling. And what it gives, so basically this is just to remind what are the degrees of freedom for iridates. So it has 5 T2G electrons, and if spin orbit coupling would be small, we would be dealing with spin 1/2 moments, while because spin orbit coupling is large, these levels are split in the low levels quadruplet of J effective 3/2, and then one electron or one hole is occupying this J effective 1/2 state, and basically we again have a kind of a quantum physics in these materials. And then it was a really very great work by Georgia Kelly and Ginyat Khaliulin, who was actually showing that this isospin, this J effective 1/2, they are a very complex object because they are, it's a mixture of the spin degrees of freedom with one orbital index and another, so spin up with orbital angular momentum equal to 0 and spin down with orbital angular momentum equal to 1. So basically we are looking how this interesting and strange object are interacting in different lattices. And what is important, since in the wave function describing these isospins, now both spin and orbital angular momentums are present, then these magnetic moments now know about the lattices, and we can get different anisotropic interactions on different lattices. And already in this work, basically what they show that if we have edge-sharing octahedra, so here in the middle are iridium atoms and they're surrounded by oxygen octahedra. So in this geometry, interactions remains, roughly speaking, isotropic, Heisenberg-like, with small dipole-dipole interaction. And if you have some corner-sharing geometry, so you have this 90 degrees super exchange, then more interesting anisotropic interaction can appear. And for example, one of them is the Kitaev interaction. So just to give you some materials which were studied, so for this type of geometry, the most studied compound was strontium 2 iridium 4, and the recent data that if it's doped, it shows some features resembling superconductivity, though superconductivity were not yet confirmed, but this compound is in a sense very similar to the parent compound for cuprates. And for 90 degrees geometry, the compounds which were studied quite a lot is sodium iridate and lithium iridate. In all of them, there is this geometry, and for lithium iridate, nowadays there's two-dimensional and also three-dimensional versions. Just to once again remind you why Kitaev physics is attracting a lot of attention. Basically, Alexei Kitaev, he proposed this model in 2006, and originally this model looks kind of artificially, because in this model, each component of spin interacts along a certain type of the bonds. For example, along all red bonds, only X component of spin will be interacting. This model is exactly solvable, and we know that there are not so many exactly solvable two-dimensional models. Moreover, it's also exactly solvable in three dimension if it's realized on these hyper-honeycomb lattices. Then the ground state is spin liquid, and there are fractionalized excitations, which might be a problem in some experiments. So it's a very interesting playground, because due to exact solution, we can really compute a certain quantity and compare them with the experiment. Just to remind what I mean by this spin liquid, so basically, once again, here my Wrangel fermions are coming into play in a slightly different context when it was discussed in this conference, but we can substitute the, we can express the spin degrees of freedom in terms of my Wrangel fermions, so on this honeycomb lattice, that's how they are introduced, where A would be the real electron operators, and basically, the B Majorana fermion can be formed into the bond variables. So what do we have? We basically, when we rewrite this Hamiltonian in terms, the spin Hamiltonian, Kitaev spin Hamiltonian in terms of the Majorana fermions, we can combine here as a bond variables multiplied by C operators. These U variables are actually static quantities, these are bond variables. And it comes from the fact that there is one true physical quantity, which is a plaquette operator, which is nothing else as a product of spin operator around one of the hexagonal plaquette of the honeycomb lattice. And this quantity is conserved. It's commutative with the Hamiltonian. And since this quantity can be rewritten in terms of these U operators, this quantity are also static. Basically, what one can do, one can just put the expectation value here. And then the remaining Hamiltonian for the C Majorana fermion is nothing else as the Hopping Hamiltonian with a certain Hopping parameter, which depends on the flux state. So once again, it can be look what is the ground state. So since all the flux sectors are orthogonal to each other, then basically in each of the flux sector we can compute this spectrum. The ground state is flux free. And basically you can see that the flux can be either zero or pi because this product of this plaquette operator is either one or minus, it's one or minus one. Okay. So basically, there is a certain spectrum, and it's all exact results. And that's why people were quite attracted to this model. So this, the ground state is spin liquid with a well-defined excitations. Why people look to the materials is because in this paper, which I already discussed, they showed that the spin liquid ground state which is exact in the Kitaev limit. So here there is a certain parameterization. You can parameterize two parameters. So it was suggested in this paper that in real materials, in the iridates, it's not only the Kitaev interaction, which comes from this 90 degree super exchange, but also Heisenberg interaction, which comes from direct overlap of iridium ions, and it's Heisenberg-like. So they showed that, so here one corresponds to only Kitaev interaction, and if you go in this direction, you can see that spin liquid survives with respect to small perturbative Heisenberg interaction. And there was experimental interest to this system because people were thinking if it would be stable just in one point, it would be no experimental interest, but since it has the region of stability, then that caused this interest. Another phases which were obtained in this phase diagram. So it's basically Niel antiferromagnet, which we know should be the ground state when we have only Heisenberg interaction on the honeycomb lattice. And in between, in the intermediate values of Kitaev interaction, there is a stripy antiferromagnet. So when people study, as I said, sodium iridate was one of the mostly studied compounds. So first of all, what they see that up to now, none of the compounds show the spin liquid ground state. Probably spin liquid somehow show itself in the excitation spectrum. But in sodium iridate, in addition to that, what was shown that the ground state is not stripy phase, which is next to the spin liquid phase in the simplest Kitaev-Heisenberg model. But it's another antiferromagnetic zigzag phase, which is shown like this. So basically, you have two types of the ferromagnetic bonds and one type of antiferromagnetic bonds. So, and it was some neutron scattering data and Riggs data, which showed that, in fact, the excitation spectrum are compatible only with this state. The question is, what is the model which would produce this phase? Obviously, the minimal Kitaev-Heisenberg model does not do the job. And that was suggestions how to extend this model to include further neighbor interactions. But in order to resolve all the puzzles related to this compound, this further high, like second neighbor and third neighbor Heisenberg interaction should be rather large. So basically what we did, we revised this super exchange model based on some tight bonding model by Katerina Feistova et al. That's the Rosa Valenti group. And we just saw that the second neighbor hoppings are quite large. And basically what we did, we looked at all possible super exchange passes, and we saw that if we compute the second neighbor coupling, it has not only Heisenberg component, but it has exactly the same symmetry Kitaev component. Basically, you can see here there are four passes and they add to each other. You can go from this iridium to oxygen to sodium to oxygen and back to iridium, and it couples the same orbital, so it produces the same kind of Kitaev physics, and this interaction for this compound is actually not small. The reason for this is very natural, is just the sodium ion, which sits inside the structure, is very big diffusive ion, so basically the hopping processes are quite large. So what we did, then we just add this Kitaev interaction to the model. Actually, what we also found that for sodium iridate, Kitaev interaction on the second neighbor is interferomagnetic, while the Kitaev interaction on the nearest neighbor is antiferromagnetic, and with these realistic numbers which we obtained from the super exchange calculation, basically we got this exact state. We got antiferromagnetic Curie-Weiss temperature, and that was a puzzle for experimentalists for quite a long time. How, with the dominating Kitaev interaction, which is ferromagnetic, how to obtain large antiferromagnetic Curie-Weiss temperature. And what is also important that in our calculation, in this model, this K2 interaction, let me explain this figure. So if you can, so here the circles are for iridium ions. And basically, if we take two iridium ions, which are second neighbors and which are coupled by green and blue bonds, means that nearest neighbor interaction would be either XX and YY, for example, then the second neighbor coupling is always red. So the K2 anisotropic interaction does not lower the symmetry of the model. So it was very recent experiment about the ordering of the spins in this compound. And what they show that the spins actually lay in the phase diagonals, which is also in contradiction with any of the nearest neighbor models, like Kitaev-Heisenberg model, which would choose cubic axis as the direction of the ordering, if the direction of the spin variables. So basically one can understand so how it works. So if you look to one of the zigzag, then basically you have in the already in mean field, you choose the easy plane, because since the strongest interaction is nearest neighbor ferromagnetic Kitaev interaction, then you want to satisfy this bond. And if you do fluctuational analysis, then you see that the cubic axis is selected. But now we did this inclusion of fluctuations, and basically due to this Kitaev interaction, where so the four second neighbor bonds would be satisfied for the second neighbor Kitaev interaction, you can show that actually this minimum of fluctuational energy are in this diagonal direction, so K2 is important. Okay, so let me just say that Kitaev interactions, both nearest neighbor and second neighbor interactions, are important, at least for sodium 2 iridium 03, but actually for other compounds as well. So the, this is the, basically the summary of what I said, that the dominant interaction in all of these compounds are nearest neighbor Kitaev interaction, and the Kitaev interaction on the second neighbor is actually the second largest energy scale, at least for sodium iridate, and the interplay of K1 and K2 already stabilized the zigzag phase, and many puzzles are resolved. So, okay, so this is just this justification why K2 is important. So this is the model. We decided, okay, let's read of all secondary interaction and just look to the essence. So this is the model, this new model on the honeycomb lattice, where we only have anisotropic interaction. So Kitaev K1 interaction would be Kitaev interaction on the nearest neighbors, and K2 would be the Kitaev interaction on the second neighbors. And once again, which component of spin is interacting, it's corresponding to this plot. Let me tell results first. I don't know how well I'm doing with time, so the results are different. So this is the result of our work. So first of all, what we found that this model holds many unconventional properties. For example, the thermal and so classical and quantum spins behave completely different, and therefore the role of thermal and quantum fluctuation through order by disorder in the selecting of the states is very different. Second is that magnetic phases, the true long-range magnetic order is stabilized only for quantum spins. It has very classical characteristics, actually Ising-like order, but it cannot be stabilized for classical spins, and that's related to the different symmetry of the classical and quantum K1, K2 symmetry of the model. So the classical spins can have only pneumatic order at a finite temperature, and what is also important, the numerical calculations show that Kitaev spin liquid, so now we are looking for the competition of Kitaev spin liquid with the K2 perturbation, so it's very fragile with respect to this perturbation, much more fragile than against the Heisenberg terms, and that basically shows that sodium iridate is deep into magnetic phase. And it actually tells experimentalists to which compounds to look if they want to find this Kitaev spin liquid phase. So basically the idea is kill K2 interaction by making the central ion smaller. Okay, so the classical analysis, let's look not for quantum spin but for classical spins. Then we can use the Luttinger-Tietze theorem and basically look what is the degeneracy of the classical ground state. And one can show that the degeneracy is actually extensive. So because you see the, since the couplings are anisotropic, so when we do, using the Luttinger-Tietze theorem, we go to the Fourier space and basically we are looking to the eigenvalues, maximum eigenvalues for this matrix lambda ij. It has also the spin index. So basically here are the eigenvalues, and for each direction of spin, x, y, and z, they are minimized or maximized if you want, along, so the minimum of eigenvalues is along a certain lies in the K space. So we have line degeneracy. And at t equals zero, basically all these lines are degenerate. So the degeneracy of the ground state is free. Free coming is from the direction of spin, and 2 to the power of L. And I will explain where it comes from. It's basically the number of ladders which scales with the system size. So this degeneracy is not accidental, but it's actually related to the sliding gauge-like symmetry of the classical K1, K2 Hamiltonian. Let me explain what I mean by this sliding symmetries. So here's the picture, okay? So let me assume one of the states. One of the states, for example, I assume the states, or I look to the eigenvalues of lambda z. So I put all the spins along z direction, and just for simplicity, I choose this combination of sides. Both K1 and K2 interactions are ferromagnetic. So one of the states, so here is this nearest neighbor bond. So these are the nearest neighbor z bonds. These are nearest neighbor x and y bonds. So and then you can form the second neighbor bonds and see what is what. So basically, its interaction is ferromagnetic. So I will have along the Z bonds, I will have the order. I would put all the bonds along blue circles, along plus Z direction, and along these yellow circles, minus Z direction. So classically, this state and the state where I took one of the ladder and flip all the signs, classically they are degenerate. So basically I can flip one ladder or I can flip all of them, then it would be this situation. All these states are degenerate, and basically they correspond to these blue lines in this Brillouin zone. So all these states are degenerate. And that's what I call by sliding symmetry. And for classical spins, it's clear why we can do it, because all of these ladders, for the nearest neighbor, you can see that they are coupled by X and Y bonds, but I put all the spins along Z direction, so classically there are no processes. So therefore, at T equals zero, all these states are degenerate. I can also put the spins with X or Y direction. If I go, so this is just another example, but the idea is exactly the same. I just look to the different part of the phase diagram, looking for different signs. Now I have antiferromagnetic couplings, so I will have these antiferromagnetic letters. If I go to the finite temperature, what I see? If I go to the very high temperature, then, and this is a result of the classical Monte Carlo, then I will see, and okay, and then what else we did? So we parameterize this K1 and K2 interaction with angle phi, and basically this line corresponds to K1 interaction only, so K2 interaction here is zero because K1 is cosine, and that vertical would correspond to K2 interaction. So here I do have spin liquid, and basically in the spin liquid, if I go to the high temperature, then all the points in the brilliant zone would correspond to my classical degeneracy for this state. And then I go away from this, so when K2 is non-zero, I see these lines, and these lines correspond to this minimum of energy. And then what happens is if I go to low temperature, then I see very sharp pneumatic-like order, and then only certain types of the lines are chosen. So basically, thermal fluctuation choose only one combination, one direction of spin, x, y, or z direction of thing. And once again, it's a first order phase transition, quite sharp. You can see it in this specific kit. Okay, so this is the classical picture. At fine, at zero temperature, we have classical. Okay. So basically, I'm going to the quantum case, and what I want to say that quantum case is very different. And the difference comes from the fact that the model itself does not have this sliding symmetry. What I mean by this? So this is the picture, classical picture, which I showed you, where I flip, compared to this case, only one letter. In order to do it, I should combine the pi rotation in space and time reversal operation. But I should apply time reversal operation locally. And for quantum system, there are no local time or reversal operators. So what does it mean? That means that these letters must couple due to some quantum mechanical processes. And this quantum mechanical process, we can actually look in perturbation theory. And we will see that it gives possibility for long-range order, both at t equals zero and at finite temperature. Okay, so there are three different types of processes here, and the idea is the following. So we assume that x and y coupling are smaller, and that's our perturbation theory. So x and y coupling would be a certain number r, which is smaller than one, from the z coupling. And these couplings are three types, so it can involve only a nearest neighbor like this. They can involve nearest and second neighbors, and only second neighbors interaction. Okay, three types of processes give us three different types of couplings, but what it does actually, let me just quickly say that it couples these letters. So details apart, what left is only some discrete degeneracy, okay? So what I do here, I compute this these couplings from perturbative theory, so R is this perturbative parameter. So then this this term, the first term, basically, which I call JW, this is like Plaquette term, and this term supports spin liquid. And you can see that this is the parameterization in the parts where we expect to see Kitaev spin liquid near 0 and 1 and 2, so these terms are dominating. And in between, in these magnetic ordered phases, there is two other processes which coupled like this. So these terms involve only a second neighbor Kitaev interaction, and like this, which involves both nearest neighbor and second neighbor coupling. So these terms can be computed perturbatively, and we see that in the biggest part of the phase diagram, J1 interaction is dominating. So it leads to a certain type of long-range order. So we obtained it first perturbatively, and then Ioannis did exact diagonalization. So this quantum phase diagram is the result of exact diagonalization, and where you can see that quantum spin liquid is extremely fragile, so it's break at when the K2 interaction is actually 0.025 pi, so it's very close. It's very, so this phase is narrow, And then what we get already for these phases, just without any Heisenberg interaction, we can get zigzag interaction in the part phase of the phase diagram where K1 and K2 have different size. There are many interesting properties of this phase diagram, but in any case, long-range order is possible for quantum spins. Last thing which I want to show is the result from our exact diagonalization. So here a few things are computed. So here what is computed is the expectation value of Plaquette operator, and you see that when we are at the point where we have only nearest neighbor Kitaev interaction, so in the quantum Kitaev spin liquid, is equal to 1, and then it's very fastly dropped to a very small value, basically 0 value in the magnetically ordered phase. So this actually shows that the phase transition is of the first order. What else we see, and here is both a result from the spin wave calculation and from exact diagonalization, that the spin lengths remain very close to 1/2. Basically, fluctuations are quantum fluctuations, or quantum fluctuations are basically negligible, so the spins are, the order is very classical. Nevertheless, it can only be stabilized by quantum processes. And here is the plot of the spin-spin correlation function in the real space. And what you can see that if you are inside quantum spin liquid, so that's the left column, then the interactions, the correlations are extremely short range, as it should be in the Kitaev spin liquid. This is a known fact. And basically here, the size of the circle corresponds to the value of the correlation function. Once you go into a magnetically ordered phase, then you truly see a long-range order. So basically, that's what I want to tell you. So thank you for your attention.